morning. Welcome to St. Andrew's Episcopal Church on this fourth Sunday after Pentecost. One announcement. You may have noticed over the last several weeks that two of our windows have come and gone and returned again. Our St. Andrew's window over here was restored by Foster's Glass here in Bryan. Then it came back, and then that one disappeared, and then was restored again by Foster's Glass, and I'm grateful to the Gloria Sale Trust Fund, which provided the funds for us to make the restoration of those two windows. So I want to thank that trust fund, and especially Stephanie Sales Singleton, who worked with us to make this all possible. So thank you to them, and thank you to Foster's Glass, which is located right here in Bryan, for restoring our windows. We'll now begin the service in just a moment. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
And blessed be his kingdom, now and forever. Amen.
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Almighty God, you have built your church upon the foundation of the apostles and prophets, Jesus Christ himself being the chief cornerstone. Grant us so to be joined together in unity of spirit by their teaching, that we may be made a holy temple acceptable to you. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Genesis. God tested Abraham. He said to him, Abraham, and he said, here I am. He said, take your son, your only son Isaac, whom you love, and go to the land of Moriah, and offer him there as a burnt offering on one of the mountains that I shall show you. So Abraham rose early in the morning, saddled his donkey, and took two of his young men with him, and his son Isaac. He cut the wood for the burnt offering and set out and went to the place in the distance that God had shown him. On the third day, Abraham looked up and saw the place far away. Then Abraham said to his young men, stay here with the donkey. The boy and I will go over there. We will worship, and then we will come back to you. Abraham took the wood of the burnt offering and laid it on his son Isaac, and he himself carried the fire and the knife. So the two of them walked on together. Isaac said to his father Abraham, Father, and he said, here I am, my son. He said, the fire and the wood are here, but where is the lamb for the burnt offering? Abraham said, God himself will provide the lamb for a burnt offering, my son. So the two of them went on together. When they came to the place that God had shown him, Abraham built an altar there and laid the wood in order. He bound his son Isaac and laid him on the altar on top of the wood. Then Abraham reached out his hand and took the knife to kill his son. But the angel of the Lord called to him from heaven and said, Abraham, Abraham. And he said, here I am. The angel said, do not lay your hand on the boy or do anything to him. For now I know that you fear God, since you have not withheld your son, your only son, from me. And Abraham looked up and saw a ram caught in a thicket by its horns. Abraham went and took the ram and offered it up as a burnt offering instead of his son. So Abraham called that place, the Lord will provide. As it is said to this day, on the mount of the Lord it shall be provided. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Let us read together Psalm 13, responsively by half verse. How long, O Lord, will you forget me forever?
How long will you hide your face from me?
How long shall I have perplexity in my mind and grief in my heart day after day.
How long shall my enemy triumph over me?
Look upon me and answer me, O Lord my God.
Give light to my eyes, lest I sleep in death.
Lest my enemies say I have prevailed over him.
And my foes rejoice that I have fallen.
But I put my trust in your mercy.
My heart is joyful because of your saving help.
I will sing to the Lord, for he has dealt with me richly.
I will praise the name of the Lord Most High.
A reading from Paul's letter to the church in Rome. Do not let sin exercise dominion in your mortal bodies to make you obey their passions. No longer present your members to sin as instruments of wickedness, but present yourselves to God as those who have been brought from death to life, and present your members to God as instruments of righteousness. For sin will have no dominion over you, since you are not under law, but under grace. What then? Should we sin because we are not under law, but under grace? By no means. Do you not know that if you present yourselves to anyone as obedient slaves, you are slaves of the one whom you obey, either of sin, which leads to death, or of obedience, which leads to righteousness? But thanks be to God that you, having once been slaves of sin, have become obedient from the heart to the form of teaching to which you were entrusted, and that you, having been set free from sin, have become slaves of righteousness. I'm speaking in human terms because of your natural limitations. For just as you once presented your members as slaves to impurity and greater iniquity, so now present your members as slaves to righteousness for sanctification. When you were slaves of sin, you were free in regard to righteousness. So what advantage did you get then from the things of which you are now ashamed? The end of those things is death. But now that you have been freed from sin and enslaved to God, the advantage you get is sanctification. The end is eternal life. For the wages of sin is death, but the free gift of God is eternal life in Jesus Christ our Lord. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Matthew.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
Jesus said, "Whoever welcomes you welcomes me, and whoever welcomes me welcomes the one who sent me. Whoever welcomes a prophet in the name of a prophet will receive a prophet's reward. And whoever welcomes a righteous person in the name of a righteous person will receive the reward of the righteous. And whoever gives even a cup of cold water to one of these little ones in the name of a disciple, truly I tell you, none of these will lose their reward. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Please be seated. Well, as many folks know, last summer, I participated in a 60-mile backpacking trek in the mountains of New Mexico. I was with a group of Boy Scouts and adult leaders from Troop 1300, and despite its challenges, we had a fantastic experience. And during the trek, we would typically camp far from anyone else, and we would seldom see anyone else on the trails. But every now and then, we would go to a camp or make our way to a camp or stop at a site that would have activities for things for these scouts to do. Like one afternoon, we sat in a sweat lodge and dumped a bucket of cold water over our heads. It was actually quite refreshing. And one day, we stopped at a camp which was modeled on an old logging camp, and actually the staff who lived and worked there did logging for Philmont. So we were there to take a rest, to take a break, and learn a little about the camp and logging. And while we were there, I noticed a big wooden chest, which had written on it in large block letters, God Box. God Box. Now, come to find out, the God Box contained Bibles, prayer books, and other literature from a variety of Christian denominations and other religions. It was there for us to access as we needed it. You could borrow a Bible or take it with you and drop it off sometime in the future at some other God Box at a different camp. You know, one of the points of the Scout Law, the last point of the Scout Law, is a Scout is reverent. And so the God Boxes were there to support that point of the Scout Law. But the funny thing is that we really can't put God in a box, even though we often try. It manifests itself, putting God in a box, manifests itself in our certainty about matters of theological doctrines about God and what God would have us do, as if we mortal creatures can have the mind of God, as if God were an object of our experience like a table or chair, something we could observe, move around, or manipulate. Putting God in the box manifests itself when we automatically believe God is on our side when we engage in conflict. I mentioned her last week, but I'll mention her again, Anne Lamott. Anne Lamott says, if you can safely assume you've created God in your own image, when it turns out that God hates all the people that you do. You can safely assume that you have created God in your own image when it turns out that God hates all the same people that you do. Now, that doesn't mean we can't know God in some way. We believe in revelation, that God has made himself known to us in creation, through the prophets, in history, and most fully in Jesus Christ. Yet we must still sift and interpret what we have learned about God in revelation. Now, we sometimes think we have it all figured out, and we believe God is omnipresent, omniscient, and omnipotent, that God is a God of compassion and steadfast love. And then we find stories in the Bible which really challenge that, which make it hard to put God in a box. Stories in which God is depicted as capricious, if not even cruel. And one of those stories we have today is the story of God, Abraham, and Isaac. Genesis introduces us to Abraham in chapter 12 when the Lord said to Abraham, go from your country and your kindred to the land that I will show you, and I will make of you a great nation. In you, all the nations of the world will be blessed. And then later, God tells Abraham that his descendants will be as many as the stars in the sky. And so begins Abraham's journey. And eventually, a son is born to Abraham, his wife, Sarah. And later after that, after their son Isaac was born, God tested Abraham, it says, by commanding him, take your son, your only son, Isaac, the one whom you love, and go to the land of Moriah, and offer him there as a burnt offering on the mountain, I will show you. Offer him there as a burnt offering on the mountain, I will show you. And so Abraham sets out to do just that. So what kind of God is that? Seems cruel to me for a God to command his so far faithful servant to take his only son and offer him as a sacrifice. It's not unlike the story of Job. The story of Job, where God allows Satan to ruin the life of the righteous Job to see whether Job would remain faithful. Well, at the mountain, we know that when Abraham reached out his hand and took the knife to kill his son, the angel of the Lord came down from heaven and said, "Abraham, Abraham, do not lay your hand on the son or do anything to him. For I know that you fear God, since you have not withheld your son, your only son, from me." And that is when Abraham looked up and saw a ram caught in a thicket. And Abraham went and took the ram and offered it as a burnt offering instead of his son. And so Abraham called that place, "The Lord will provide." Now, it has been thought that this story is somehow related to some other religions in Canaan, in the land of Canaan, which required the sacrifice of children. This story is trying to demonstrate that the God of Israel was not that kind of God and did not require such sacrifices. It's been interpreted to be about Abraham's faith and obedience. And it's been interpreted to understand that God does make provision for his people. Now, when it comes to texts like this and others we find in the Bible which don't quite align with what we believe about God, texts which disturb us and make us feel uncomfortable, it's important to understand them within the context of the larger story of the Bible. It's important to get behind the text and understand who wrote it, why it was written, why it was included, to understand the context of when and where it was written. These are all necessary and important things to do. But I think it's also important for us to let these stories disturb us, to let the mystery of God sink in, to remind us that we can't put God in a box, to remind us that God is a mystery. As much as we try to plumb the depths of God, God ultimately is a mystery beyond our understanding. Now, that doesn't mean we stop trying to understand God and why God does what God does. To say that God and God's ways are a mystery beyond anything we can say would be what Urban T. Holmes calls a false appeal to mystery. Urban T. Holmes was a theologian and dean of the School of Theology at Swanee and authored many books in the 1960s and 70s. And in his book on Christian believing, he names false appeals to mystery as one of the temptations of Christian practice and belief. An example of a false appeal to mystery would be something like a priest trying to comfort someone who had lost a loved one who was young or died unexpectedly by saying something like, "It was God's will," or "The Lord works in mysterious ways." That lets God off the hook. It lets ourselves off the hook too easily. There are ways of understanding God's will and how God works in the world, however limited and incomplete they may be. There are ways of understanding how God does work in the world. The problem with false appeals to mystery, Holmes says, is that they prevent us from dealing with the implications of what we believe. He says, "Religion's positive interaction with the public world demands that we engage in a penetrating critical analysis of all of our attempts to express in words and ideas our religious experience and faith." A form of the false appeal to mystery now occurs most obviously to me these days when some terrible event occurs, especially, it seems, in relation to gun violence, when the response is simply offering thoughts and prayers, rather than also engaging in the deep work of exploring what God is calling us to do when it comes to gun violence and even other issues of the day, whether it's COVID-19, racial injustice, or economic inequality. Simply offering thoughts and prayers on its own is another form of a false appeal to mystery, which avoids dealing with the implications of what we are to do as followers of Jesus Christ, based on who we believe he is and what God has done through him. So one temptation is to put God in the box and believe we understand exactly who God is and what God would have us do. when the best thing is to say sometimes simply, I don't know. Let's try to find out. The other temptation is to make false appeals to mystery and say God and God's ways are inscrutable to our simple minds and fall back on platitudes and not deal with the implications of our faith. Instead, may we take the difficult texts like this one of Abraham, Isaac, and wrestle with them in light of the whole story of God as expressed in the words of the Bible and the context in which it was written. If the church is going to be a resource for people to understand their lives and what God is doing in the world, may we have the courage to engage in a critical analysis of our experience of Jesus Christ and our faith in him. Sometimes we may be disturbed by what we find out. We might be made uncomfortable. And yet, by doing so, our faith will become more authentic, and our faith will be more relevant. Amen. Let us now stand and affirm the faith of the church in the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father of the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Let us pray for the church and for the world. Grant, Almighty God, that all who confess your name may be united in your truth, live together in your love, and reveal your glory in the world, especially the presiding Bishop Michael, our bishops Andy, Jeff, Hector, and Kay, Brian, our curate, and Daryl, our rector. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Guide the people of this land and of all the nations in the ways of justice and peace, that we may honor one another and serve the common good. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Give us all a reverence for the earth as your own creation, that we may use its resources rightly in the service of others and to your honor and glory. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Bless all whose lives are closely linked with ours, Aaron, Alex, Nathan S., D., Jackson, and Jim K. Grant that we may serve Christ in them and love one another as he loves us. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Comfort and heal all those who suffer in body, mind, or spirit, especially Dixie, Paul, and Kathy W. Give them courage and hope in their troubles and bring them the joy of your salvation. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We commend to your mercy all who have died, that your will for them may be fulfilled, and we pray that we may share with all your saints in your eternal kingdom. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Almighty God, to whom our needs are known before we ask, help us to ask only what accords with your will, and those good things which we dare not or in our blindness cannot ask, grant us for the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor.
Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. Amen.
Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life.
Amen.
We stand. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
I appeal to you, brothers and sisters, by the mercies of God, to present yourselves as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship.
Thank you.
And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God, and of his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you forever. Go forth in the name of Christ.